James Nghiem.
How's it going?
It's going well. It's going well. I have an introduction for you here. It's real, real proper, James.
It looks really long.
Yeah. We're here, though, to talk about the comedy.
The comedy.
Yes. The comedy. Not comedy in general, but the comedy.
Stand-up.
That is yours.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we can talk about other people's comedy. That's fine.
And
Chris Rock is a good topic. You want to talk about Chris Rock?
Well, hold that thought. Hold that thought. James here has opened up for
Chris Rock.
No. He's opened up for well-known comedians like Todd Barry, who was a supporting actor in The Wrestler.
Yeah.
For 2 seconds.
Who's also really good friends with Chris Rock. Okay. Not about Chris Rock.
Okay. Now, when a joke comes to you, well, first off, how does a joke come to you, and how do you handle it?
That's really intense.
Yeah.
How does it come to me, and how do I handle it? Like, the honest answer, I mean, just bullshit, because bullshit.
Well, I like an honest answer. I like the truth.
I don't know, I just write jokes all the time, and I just work on it all the time.
Okay.
It's very boring.
Yeah. But, you know, you keep, like, notebooks like Eminem?
No, I just save words in my phone. Like, every now and then, I have an idea for a joke, and I don't have time to write it, so I write one word to remember it.
Mm.
Or if I don't remember it, I just wake up the next day with, like, a bunch of random words in my phone that don't make sense, like umbrella or, like, toothpaste.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You ever think about hiring, like, a secretary to take care of that? You just
give her
your drunk notes and
yeah.
Then,
write this for me.
Make it, put it into a word processor.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah. That would be ideal, I guess.
When you're doing your comedy, there is always going to be that guy who's got a little extra energy to expend.
Yeah.
A heckler.
Oh, yeah.
How do most comedians that you yourself and that you've known,
yeah,
how do they train to combat hecklers? That sounds like very difficult.
They train on job, basically.
On the job?
Yeah, right? Basically.
Yeah.
There's no like course that you go to where
there's not a school.
Yeah, where there's a room of just people that are paid to just yell stuff at you for days and days until you just get good at like telling them.
Yeah. Because some people are really great at it.
Yeah,
but
definitely.
Then some people kind of, I mean, I guess you could ignore them.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah.
You can do whatever you want. Honestly, that's the best way to handle a heckler is just to do what you feel like doing.
Yeah.
Give them crap or going on with your set.
Yeah. How have you traditionally handled those types of personalities?
Just depend on my mood. I just sometimes I go with it and sometimes I get really mad and go off on them.
Yeah. Then has it gotten a lot easier for you?
Comedy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're like, it's like a...
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like breathing. Cool and crazy. Like, I picture trying to be cool as this like game of chicken, and crazy is the cliff that you get, right? Like, you drive as close to the cliff as you can to get as cool as you can before you get crazy. And some people are like, don't want to play the game. Just like, fuck this. They don't drive at all. They just like drive 2 feet, become an accountant. They're cool. They're good. That's as cool as they want to get. And then some people drive over the cliff and they just like fucking go nuts and like, I'm fucking like bears now, I'm so goddamn cool. It's like, no man, you're crazy. You've gone over the edge. I think I've gone over the edge. I was thinking recently, I think I figured out abortion. Like, that's how cool I think I am, but I might just be crazy. And I don't want to make light of abortion as a thing, but as a political argument, it's hilarious to me. Because if you simplify the abortion argument to either side, on either side of the argument, to the simplest terms, here's exactly how it sounds. Hey James, do you like freedom or do you like babies? I don't know, man. Both those sound good. Can I like both freedom and babies? Nah, you can't like freedom and babies, James. They're polar opposites of each other. Stupid.
How about cussing?
Cussing?
What's your philosophy on cussing and how it plays into what's funny?
I do it because I do it naturally.
Yeah, that's true.
I feel like if I don't, it's just how I talk. So I just do it because that's how I talk. I don't do it to make my jokes like, oh, if I say an F word, it's going to make this
like,
joke better. But it's going to make it feel more natural for me
because
it's how I speak.
Sure, sure. So of the drumming, of the blogging, of the video editing, you would say that comedy is probably the passion of your life right now.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
Most, yeah. I mean, I can't say it's not. It's basically mostly what I do. Like, I'm not going to do comedy after the show's over, and I'll probably do it tomorrow if I can.
Sure.
I think that's all the experimental bullshit I have. I got one more stupid shit. I'm gonna tell this bullshit joke and I'm gonna tell a story about it. How about that? That's a good compromise. I'm gonna do both. Please, both you guys. Has anybody into game shows?
Yeah!
Has anybody ever seen that show, Are You Smarter Than a Fifth Grader?
Yeah.
I think that show's bullshit, because if a fifth grader is ever on the verge of outsmarting you, you can just hit them with some real world shit that they don't know about yet, you know? Like, no, I do not know what the Pythagorean theorem is, but riddle me this, punk! What does pussy taste like? People, cheeseburgers! Nah, not like cheeseburgers. I win. And that's a stupid joke, and I get that. You guys like it, I like it too sometimes. Here's the story of that joke, and the most ironic thing that's ever happened in my life. I was at this bar, this very same bar, and this girl is like eyeballing me, and she had never met me before. And she said, hey, do you tell jokes? And I said, yes. And she's like, do you tell a joke about fifth graders? And I was like, yeah, I kind of do. And she's like, I've never seen you before. My friend described me to you. Described me to me. What the fuck? I fucked it up somehow. Her friend described me to her. Which basically means she said, there's an Asian guy going around telling fifth grader pussy jokes. But she was like, oh, you're the pussy guy. Which is hilarious to me. Which is ironic. It's not ironic, because I'm into it. I just don't get it a lot. So ironic's not the best word. But I just think it's funny that I'm the pussy guy. That's me. If you look up on Wikipedia, the pussy guy, would you expect to see me? No, but it's totally me. That's my time, everybody. Thank you.
Some of your blogs about this is one of the last things I want to bring up about mixed martial arts. What draws you to that sport? I mean, you've done reporting on mixed martial arts.
Yeah, I just did that because nobody else was covering it. I think there's kind of a market for it. And one of my friends used to fight in Japan, and I don't know, it's kind of fun sometimes. I guess it's really brutal and violent, but
sure.
There's some.
You're not a brutal and violent person.
I like the I don't know. Like to me, like being a fighter and being a comedian is. I got a lot of respect for fighters because like sometimes when I get off stage, it feels like I got the shit kicked out of me.
Yeah.
But like fighters, if you like you have a bad fight, you really do get hurt, and like you gotta love to do that. If not else, why would you do that? You know.
I'm kind of pretentious, but not like in the real life. Just like when I'm playing video games, like I'm not a vegan. But I am when I play Mario Brothers. Like Starman and fucking Raccoon Suits. Fuck that. That shit has a face. I can't use that. Fire flowers and mushrooms for me. Thank you for getting that.
In and be sure to visit robotsafecity.com to check out Oklahoma City's own original comedians as produced by James Nghiem. And remember, if it's not the Danny Marroquin show and you're not talking, you probably have something to hide.
Just like it, but I'm